Good morning, good morning, good morning. Happy Wednesday to you all. It's 7 a.m. and it's time for our Wednesday morning prayer call. Hope everyone is doing well. Hope that you are off to a great start on your day. Before we jump into our prayer, I wanted to share something that's on my heart. And I want to use 1 Samuel chapter number 30, verse number 5 as the encouragement. So in 1 Samuel chapter number 30, David and his men have just returned back home to Ziklag. They were hanging out with the Philistines. David was on the run from King Saul, who was still trying to kill him. He had found refuge among King Achish, who led the Philistines at the time. And the King Achish and his men were going out to battle against the Israelites. And the men of Philistine rejected David and rejected David's men because they were worried that David would turn on them in the middle of the battle. And so they encouraged the king to resist David and tell David he couldn't go with them. And the king listened to his men and told David he couldn't go. And so David and his men, after being rejected by King Achish, found themselves on their journey back home to Ziklag. Chapter number 30 opens up where David and his men get back, only to get home and realize that the Amalekites have invaded Ziklag and has taken all of David and his men's possession, including their wives and their children. And David, having been rejected in chapter 29, the latter part, now comes home to find invasion has taken place in his home. And David is discouraged. David is upset. The men are discouraged. They are upset. The men now talk about stoning David because of what has transpired. Talk about stoning David. And David has led these men honorably, led these men through many battles. He has been there for these men when nobody else was there. His army made up of those who had been dishonored, had been discouraged, were those who were indebted, those who had just felt like they were the outcast. David was loyal to these men. And now, because of invasion, now because of loss, now because of rejection, these men who have been led by David now find themselves saying to David that they're upset and talk about stoning David. But verse number 5 of chapter number 30 of 1 Samuel, the Bible said, "And David encouraged himself in the Lord." And I want to deal with that for a brief moment before we go into prayer. That David, having been rejected, David having come home and found his wife and children have been kidnapped, all of his possessions have been taken from him, the men that he has led are now talking about stoning him as well. David's in a very dark place. But David taps into something that he knew worked when nothing else did. He encouraged himself in the Lord. And this morning, I want to talk to those who are listening now, because life is an unfair situation. Life does not call you in advance to tell you that it's going to knock on your door and attack you. It just happens. Life does not give you a heads up and say you have 7 days to get your house in order before we come and wreak havoc. It just does that. Life doesn't ask you before it takes your loved one or impacts your employment or goes after your children or go after your money. It just happens. There are people that you have been loyal to, that you have been faithful toward, people that you have given your last to, that when you needed them the most, they weren't there for you. People that you would never do to them what they've done to you. People who have spoken ill against your name, have spread lies and rumors about you, have betrayed you. Things that they've done to you, you would never do to them. And you find yourself in a very dark and dire situation because now you're having to do something that you're used to doing for other people. You are the encourager. You are the one who calls and checks on people. You're the one who always praying for people. And now people you've been praying for, people that you've been calling to encourage, are now finding themselves joining the chorus of people speaking against you. And now you have to do something that you typically don't do. You have to encourage yourself in the Lord. And I want to say to you this morning that when you know what God is able to do, even in your darkest times, he has not lost the ability to be trustworthy in dark places. Ladies and gentlemen, David had every reason to throw in and say, "God, I give up." Had every reason to turn his back on God. But what David had is what we have. David had history with God. David has seen God manifest himself in major ways on David's behalf. Remember now, David is the same young boy who was the eighth of Jesse's children, who in no way should have been the king of Hebron, let alone the king of Israel. David in no way should have been in the king's palace, leading the army brigade, being a harpist, being a songwriter, being a leader, married to the king's daughter, being best friends to the king's son. There is no way. But David knew that God did this. So David tapped into what he knew worked, which is the Lord. Verse 5 of chapter number 30 of 1 Samuel said, and David encouraged himself in the Lord. And once David did this and found himself encouraged, he then asked the Lord for a strategy on how to go after the Amalekites. You have to understand about the Amalekites now. If you read the text in previous chapters, the Amalekites had in previous times gone after God's people. And the Lord told them to stay their hand from attacking the Amalekites at that time. So they had given them a free pass. They gave them a free pass. And the Amalekites, in turn, instead of being appreciative of the free pass, decided they were going to invade Ziklag. The Amalekites are the same people as why Saul lost the throne, because Saul was supposed to kill the Amalekites and kill their king and leave nothing behind. But Saul decided that he was going to allow the king, King Agag, to stay alive and take their spoils. And the Lord used the prophet Samuel to kill King Agag, take the spoil, and remove the anointing off of Saul and place it on David. So David has seen the things of God. He knew what God was able to do. And now, even in a dark and dire situation, David didn't turn from God. He turned toward God. And this morning, I want to encourage your heart, because if you watch the news all day, if you read the papers all day, if you engage in conversation all day, you could find yourself discouraged, feeling downtrodden. But I want to say to you that you have to learn 1 Samuel 30 and 5, how to encourage yourself in the Lord. Listen, you can't be a professional encourager, but fail at encouraging yourself. I'll say it again. You can't be a professional encourager, meaning you're good at encouraging other people, but fail at encouraging yourself. I'll give it a different way. You can't be good at giving everybody full and you live on empty. Can I say it again? You can't be good at giving everybody full and you live on empty. Every day you're depleting yourself, depleting yourself, depleting yourself, only to come home and you are mentally and you're physically and you're emotionally and you're spiritually exhausted because you gave the world all of you and you came home dragging. I dealt with this on Monday evening, left a meeting and got home and was so exhausted, I couldn't lift my head off the pillow. Woke up yesterday morning, still exhausted. And the Lord began to deal with me about the situation and the scenario. And I share this with you because I'm not exempt from the counsel I'm trying to give you. But what I've always been able to do, even in times when I didn't want to do it, is encourage myself in the Lord, is remind myself of God's faithfulness. Remind myself of the times that God, every time that God stepped in. Reminding myself that he's the same God yesterday, today, and evermore. Whatever you are going through today, whatever you are experiencing right now, listen to me. You're not the first one to go through it. Not the only one that's going through it. You would not be the only person that went through it. But in the midst of what you're going through, here is what you need to know that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew in the lions, in the fiery furnace, what Daniel knew in the lion's den, what David learns in his life, is that God will come in where you are, stay in where you are, and then bring you out from what you were in. Please don't think that the Lord vacates the premises because you are going through something. Truthfully, you usually see God at his greatest when you're at your lowest. I'll say it again. You usually see God at his greatest when you're at your lowest. Because as long as you are strong, you depend upon your own strength, your own might. But it's when everything you have done and everything you have tried fails that you then find yourself say, okay, God, I'm gonna try it your way. Isaiah 55 says that your ways are not like his ways, neither are your thoughts like his thoughts. Think about that now. Your greatest thought still comes up less to his greatness. Your greatest thought, your greatest way is less than his ways. David had his men of 600 talk about stoning him. He had both of his wives and his children kidnapped. All of his possessions are gone. He's returned home from being rejected, only to come home after being rejected to find all of his stuff is gone. But if you keep reading 1 Samuel 30, David sought the Lord and said, Lord, shall we pursue? And if we pursue, shall we overtake? He asked God two questions. Shall we pursue? And if we pursue, shall we overtake? The Lord said, pursue, you shall overtake and recover all. If you keep reading the chapter, not only did David pursue them, David didn't lose any men in the battle. He recovered all of his possessions, overtook the enemy, and had overflow left over. Because it's hard to seek the Lord for a strategy when you're discouraged. You have to learn how to tap into a realm of encouraging yourself, how to get alone, cut everything off, phone, TV, all your electronics, and tap into what you know. You can't lead your family when you're on E. You can't be a dutiful employee when you're on E. You can't be an encourager to somebody else when you're on E. Don't be a professional encourager and fail at encouraging yourself. It's time out for wearing the public mask and while you privately are collapsing. Giving everybody kudos and credit and you loving on them and you're encouraging them, but behind the scenes, you are depleted and you are falling. God is not impressed by your ability to look impressive. He's not impressed by the fancy cliches, I'm blessed and highly favored. That stuff is great. That's cool. That's good. I ask you how you doing. Oh, I'm blessed. I know you blessed. I get that. But how are you doing? It's okay to say, man, today I'm just exhausted. Today, man, I'm tired. I need prayer today. You're not above that situation. Even Jesus, in my closing, even Jesus, if you read the Bible closely, there were three times in Jesus' ministry where he took Peter, James, and John. Jairus' house, the Mount of Transfiguration, and the Garden of Gethsemane. But if you read about the garden a little bit closer, you will learn that what Jesus did in that garden is he told his three disciples, you stay here. I'm going to go a little bit further and pray. There's a time when you need the 12, time when you only need the three. And there's sometimes you got to get by yourself. You got to know how to tap into the things of God and trust God for decisions you have to make. Some of you have to make some serious decisions for yourself or for your family, for school, employment, health, whatever it may be. Why would you ever try to make that decision on your own? Tap into what you know. And when you feel discouraged, when you feel invisible, you feel overlooked, you got to learn how to encourage yourself in the Lord. In the Lord. I want to pray with you this morning. I want to pray that those of you who are discouraged will find yourself being revived during this day. I want to pray for you that those of you who've already made the mind you're going to give up, that God would arrest your spirit and remind you that he is still able to do the work in your life. This, what you're going through, is not too hard for God. It's too hard for you. And do not relegate your God to your impossibility. There's nothing impossible with God. It's impossible for you. And because you think so highly of yourself, you keep trying to make it better and you're making it worse. But if you take your hands off, if you lift your hand and say, Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. I'm letting you do your work in this situation. Here's what you know. If you look back over your life, I have a lot of failures. He's always been faithful. Thank you, Lord. I have a lot of failures. I tried things my way and I failed. He's always been faithful. So here's my question to you. Why wouldn't you trust the faithfulness of God versus your failing attempts? It's okay to admit, man, I messed this thing up. But he can make all things work together for the good, for them who love God and them who are called according to his purpose. So where you are, whatever posture you're in, I want to pray for you and pray with you. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for every person who's a part of this morning's prayer call. Father, I pray because you know the depth of their agony, of their pain, of their hurt, of their discouragement, of the distraction. You know what they are going through. You know what they need to hear, what they need to experience. You know what life has done to them and life is doing to them. But thank you for 1 Samuel 30, verse number 5, where David encouraged himself in the Lord. David was a leader, a mighty man of valor. He was a harpist. He was a songwriter. He was all of these great things, and yet he found himself faced with a real situation. And David didn't throw out fancy cliches, But David went to what he knew. He went to the rock that is higher than I. He tapped into you and he encouraged himself in you. And once he got encouraged, then he sought you for a strategy. I pray for my brother and my sister today who are discouraged and they're trying to make decisions through the lens of discouragement. I pray that you would speak to them and tell them to back up some. Back up some, lift their hands toward you, cry out to you, and then allow you to encourage their heart. So when they get encouraged, they can start seeing the situation through a different lens. They can start hearing your voice clearer and be able to walk and strategize and move as you so fit. God, I pray for my brother today who's trying to walk upright, who's trying to be a godly example, who's trying to lead his family and be an example to his children and others, but he feels like this world is pressing him down. I pray that you will whisper in his hearing that he will know that you see him and you are concerned about him. Pray for my sister who feel like everything that she has done is not appreciated, feel like that all of her sacrifices are in vain. I pray for that sister who's trying to keep balance. I pray for her, oh God, pray that you will remind her that she can cast all her cares upon you, for you careth for us. But I pray for all of us. I pray for us, oh God, because in the times that we are living in, it seems like there is wars and rumors of war. There is chaos, confusion all over us and all around us. But help us to unplug from that and tap into you. Help us to get our faces off Facebook and put our face back in your book, because it's there that we will find the encouragement we need to live each and every day. I pray for the one who's a professional encourager but fails at encouraging themselves. Speak to them, Lord God, and help them to understand that you want to be able to use them for your glory, and you can't fully do that if we are giving all of ourselves to everything outside of our assignment. Help us today not to throw in the towel. Help us today not to surrender. Help us today not to quit. Help us today not to walk away from that which you've ordained for us to be doing. Help us today to tap in to what we know works, which is, God, you are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. For greater is he that's within me than he that's within the world. You are faithful. If God before us, who can be against us? You are faithful. No weapon formed against us will be able to prosper. You are faithful. You are faithful. I pray the words of encouragement over my brothers and my sisters today, that they will tap into your faithfulness and stop trying to do it themselves, but trust you, trust your way in the name of Jesus. God, continue to order our steps on this Wednesday, during this week, in this month, during this hour of this very day. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before you log off, let me say this to you. John P. Key says these words. There's two times you ought to praise God. When you feel like it and when you don't. What he's saying in that is you never have a reason not to give God praise. He's always worthy. Remember, even when you fail, God remains faithful. Be encouraged in the name of Jesus. Live this way. Don't just be blessed. Live blessed. God bless you.